Hi, Shiel here, and today I want to talk about the Sun entering the T-square, and specifically the Sun opposition in Uranus. We're going to have it for a couple of days, and I think that's interesting. So without further ado, I'm going to do the intuitive channeling of this aspect, and then I'm going to come up with some cognitive completions and consult my guides. So let's see. Sun in Scorpio, opposition in Uranus in Taurus. Let's see what comes up. So the colors I see are kind of pink, white, and red. I'm working with two crystals. One of them is azestulite, and the other is red beryl or bixbite, and I'm going to channel them in the future because I'm currently absorbing their energies, but I'm kind of getting that they are fitting this energy, like a remedy to this energy. Not in the sense that I suggest you to work with them, but in the sense that they are like, those energies are remedies to the energies of the transit. And let's see how. Okay, the bixbite in Taurus is the representative of the Taurus energy, of the Uranus in Taurus. And it kind of sets the boundaries that, let's say, Mars would set there. Because, you know, the Sun is in a Mars-ruled sign. And it kind of brings the Mars, the boundary setting of Mars, to the Taurus house. In your chart. So look at the Taurus house in your chart, and what you want to do is kind of imagine yourself putting the Mars there. Set some boundaries in the Taurus house in your chart. For me, that's like a third house, and I noticed, okay. Yeah, so for me, I noticed my guidance was setting boundaries for me in the Taurus house of blogging and doing my random, my daily activities and daily routines, because I was beginning to be almost obsessed with what should I create, or, you know, what's my next move on a blog or so. And it was kind of limiting the time that I spent thinking about it. So, but that the third house can also be siblings you may need to set boundaries to. So the Uranus energy there, the Uranus in Taurus kind of gives you the unexpected things. It can be shocking events or shocking information that you get in regards to your relatives if it's the third house, but it can be in whichever house it is for you. You know, the ninth house, it can be some foreign travel, it can also be world philosophy, world view. You find, you know, like a shocking revelation that that doesn't work anymore, and you want to put the Mars there, you want to put, you know, a cut, set a boundary, or initiate. Initiation is also good, because the bixbite crystal, which can be seen as it's not necessarily a Mars crystal, but it is a red crystal, and the energy that you bring to that place is also of passion and initiation. So you can set the boundaries to what doesn't work, and you can initiate something in your Taurus house using the energy of the Scorpio. So it will be in relation to something unexpected. It will be in relation to some shocking news or shocking events that you may experience. Something that you learned. Really depending on the house that it's in. So you want to use the Mars in the Scorpio house of initiation, passion, and also even competition. Healthy competition is not a bad thing. and also boundary setting and assertiveness. You want to use the higher qualities. And then you can release a lot of blocks from your root chakra through this action and release a lot of kundalini energy and ground more. And then the other, you know, the top, the Scorpio placement, I saw the azestulite. And azestulite is, it's a whitish crystal. I saw the white azestulite. Let's see what it wants to say. Oh, it talks about like a Uranus energy. So it doesn't bring the Taurian energy to the Scorpio house. You want to bring the Uranus energy to the Scorpio house. So the sun is in Scorpio, and I spoke about it when I spoke about the sun squaring Saturn. Now I speak about the sun's opposition in Uranus. And sun can be intellect because it's illumination, right? And so the Uranus energy, you want to bring it to the Scorpio house. What do you do when you have an opposition? You have two contradicting forces that are complementary. But they don't all, but they see themselves sometimes as contradicting. So you want to create a pact. You want to give a little, you want to receive a little from what's in the opposite side. And you want to give a little from what's in your side. So you can be a partnership rather than a conflictual relationship. And so putting the azestulite energy is basically taking what's in Taurus now, that's Uranus, and that's the element of storm. I'm not sure if azestulite is storm element. Yes, it is storm element. So it's taking the element of storm and kind of bringing it to the Scorpio house and bringing enlightenment, a revelation into the Scorpio house in your chart. Yeah, revelation, enlightenment, claircognizance is also a feature of Uranus. So you want to try that out. You want to try that. In the beginning, I saw right, like from pink to white, in the Scorpio placement in your chart. So from healing to enlightenment. Right now, it's the time for enlightenment. Anything more wanting to come out? No. Anything cognitive I might want to add about that? Let me see. Well, you know, the sun is conjuncting Mars, and again, you want to use Mars as initiator, and you want to use Mars as boundary setter, assertive initiation, healthy competition. You know, be in the light, choose the light. That's, yeah, that's definitely what I'd say there. It doesn't have, you know, when the sun was in Leo, it had a lot of force, like a fixed force. And even though it is a fixed sign, even though it is a fixed sign, it is fixed water. It is deep waters. It does not hold as much force as it did. It's not going to be that pressure that it did when it was in Leo. It's going to do other things. It's going to do a lot more enlightenment than the pressure bottle. Trying to think about the weather. It's not going to cause as much extreme weather from the Scorpio side. Like the sun in Scorpio is not going to cause as much extreme weather. It doesn't mean that it won't be because it's still a Saturn, you know, square Uranus. But it's not going to cause as much turmoil as it did when it was in a fire sign, for example. There were many fires and floods. and that unbalanced. And so, yeah, I did not see like floods coming up or something like that. It doesn't mean that there won't be floods, but it won't be like extra floods because of the sun being in that position. Anything else? Any other Finances. Illuminate on the relationship with your resources. Okay. Taurus is a Venus ruled sign, and Venus is soon going to be in Capricorn. She's still in Sag. She did a great job. She did an amazing job when she passed Cato. Not an easy one, but a great one. And Venus is also trade, right? It's ruling Taurus, it's also ruling Libra. So it's also trade, it's not just relationships, but the relationships you have with matter, the relationships you have with your finances. And the sun is going to illuminate on the inner psychological, Scorpio, the inner psychological patterns, the unconscious patterns of relating to matter. So there's a contact between, again, when two planets are aspecting, you know, creating the opposition from Scorpio to Taurus axis, then we can get a chance to be illuminated. We can get the chance to have the connection between not necessarily spirit and matter, that really depends on your chart, but the hidden, psychologically hidden stuff and the tangible stuff. The deep emotions and the deep attachment and what it creates, what it manifests in the real world. So you can get a chance not only to see the sun, but also to assert Mars, to assert different patterns in your thinking, in your emotional style of relating to your resources and also to nourishment. So depending on your chart, it can be a good time after the new moon in Scorpio. After the eclipse, the eclipse can be a great time to take away certain patterns of relating that you may have experienced to nourishment, to matter, to fortune, and to relationships and to trade in your relationships with finances and money. And you know, Uranus is doing a great job of, you know, shaking our value system, shaking our economies, shaking everything Taurian already. So that's just like a chance to take a look at the deeper meaning of why is it happening, what's going on. Let's say you want to have a business, okay, and you're trying to see, I'm not making money with my business, and then you look and then a planet hits the Scorpio one, and then you're like, oh wait, when I was making money in my life, I was just spending it on things that I don't really need and don't give me great satisfaction for a long time. So how about me learning how to gain satisfaction, Taurus, for a long time, Saturn in Aquarius, long time duration, okay, long duration in space and time. So how about I change that? And then when you change the way you think about your expenses, and when you change the way you look at the value you get from your purchases, then you kind of see that there is enough, and you buy the right things, and you invest correctly, and then you fix your relationship around money, and then money can come in. So then you finally can make like a breakthrough in your business or a breakthrough in your income, because of those relations. It can, of course, also be intimate matters, like healing certain sexual traumas. You know, Scorpio, the reproductive system, and Taurus, this area is like the sex rose chakra axis. So healing the sex rose chakra axis, it can be great. You know, people are very... Should I talk about it? Yes, I should. People are very afraid of the eclipse happening next to Algol. Because Algol, you know, we all know, some of us know, represents Medusa Gorgon. She represents the myth of the woman that was raped and decapitated, so she won't be able to speak, and the rage. But there is an esoteric side to Algol. I think I spoke about it. I don't know if the videos are still on. Healing from just this, healing this axis, the sex chakra, throat chakra axis. Getting at the root of your intimacy hangoffs or traumas or even CPTSD or PTSD, and actually having a revelation, a new assertion, a learning of a new pattern, a releasing of an old pattern around your intimate relations or your relations with your intimate self, with your sensuality and sexuality. So that can also be a blessing that you can have around the time of the eclipse. It can eclipse your trauma away, literally. You can set the intention for it to do so, and wait for the eclipse. What else? Something coming into fruition this month from the Taurus new moon. So that would be like 6 months ago. What were you doing 6 months ago? What were you starting 6 months ago? Something's going to come into fruition with the Taurus full moon. That you want to be prepared for, to reap the fruits of your labor. Anything more? No, nothing more. So if you like this type of content, make sure you subscribe and click the bell. You can like the video, this helps more people to reach it, and share it with your friends who you think can benefit from this information. Comment down below, where is your Scorpio Taurus axis in your chart? What houses are they in your chart? And you can go to astro.com and look to your chart. It takes a bit more of a technique to change it to whole signs if you want to know, like, the way I work, which is just convenient and it still works, so I use whole signs. But you can use any house system. And let me know what houses are Scorpio and Taurus in your chart, and I can try to come up with what it may mean for you to have, you know, the Sun opposition Uranus, and to have the upcoming transits in November. So I'll see you in my next video. Hope you have a wonderful evening, morning, wherever you are. And yeah, bye-bye. That was me, Shirley, with The Matter of Spirit and Channeled Astrology.